हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वंस अगेन आई वेलकम यू ऑल। आई थिंक इन दिस क्लास आई विल बी एबल टू कंप्लीट द प्रेजेंट लेसन टाइटल्ड एज ऑन द रूल ऑफ द रोड Written by A.G. Gardiner. Friends, in the previous class, I talked about some of the very important views expressed by A.G. Gardiner, and the last point that he discussed is about the reasonable consideration for the rights and the feelings of others, and it is to be considered as the foundation of social conduct. In this respect, he gave a couple of examples also. And from my end, I tried my level best to explain all this. Now, in this class, I would like to proceed further, and then your author, A.G. Gardiner, now you can see his image in the background presently. He talks about few more important aspects related to human beings living in society. He says, I believe that the rights of small people and quiet people are as important to preserve as the rights of small nationalities. When I hear the aggressive bullying horn which some motorists deliberately use, I confess that I feel something boiling up in me, which is very like what I felt when Germany came trampling like a bully over Belgium. By what right, my dear sir, do you go along our highways uttering that hideous curse on all who impede your path? Cannot you announce your coming like a gentleman? Cannot you take your turn? Are you someone in particular, or are you simply a hot gospeler of the prophet Nietzsche? I find myself wondering what sort of a person it is who can sit behind that hog-like outrage without realizing that he is the spirit of Prussia incarnate and a very ugly spectacle in a civilized world. See now, in this paragraph, A.G. Gardiner talks about the importance of the rights of an individual. He strongly believed that the rights of small people and the rights of the quiet people, those who are the integral part of our society, have to be preserved at all conditions. Similarly, we should also preserve the rights of the small nations and small nationalities, which cannot really influence the rest of the world. Unless you preserve the rights of the small people, quiet people, small nationalities, a proper order cannot be seen in the society. If you really want to see a cultured society all around, the first and the most important priority of everybody should be to preserve the rights of the small, quiet people and the small nationalities as well. In this respect, A.G. Gardiner gives a couple of examples. While traveling, probably you might have experienced, sometimes we are there on the road, and of course, we are expected to follow the road, the rules of the road, as the title of the lesson is, on the rule of the road. In this respect, A.G. Gardiner gives an example of a motorist who is deliberately and intentionally honking continuously for long and sometimes for no reason. Okay, if at all you are there in your motor car and you find some sort of, you know, hurdle, you are expected to honk your horn, no doubt. But honking for no reason sometimes really create an idea in the mind of a gentleman like Gardiner. And he says that, I confess that I feel something boiling up in me, which is very like what I felt when Germany came trampling like a bully over Belgium. If you go back to the pages of the history of Europe, you will find that Germany, a country, especially during the Second World War, became very ambitious and started invading the neighboring countries. And here, A.G. Gardiner is giving an example. When Germany came trampling like a bully over Belgium, but the kind of question which is raised by A.G. Gardiner over here is, by what right, my dear sir, do you go along our highways uttering that hideous curse on all who impede your path? Now you can compare and contrast with the attitude of the motorist who is using his bellowing horn for no reason, just like the act of the German soldiers who came trampling like a bully over Belgium. Here, A.G. Gardiner questions that, can't you announce your arrival like a gentleman? Why can't you really take your own turn? Why don't you really show some sort of demeanor which is acceptable to the civilized society? See, when you talk about all these issues, you definitely realize that there are so many aspects that we need to take into consideration while living our life. Now you can see a different background on your screen, and the man that I'm trying to show you all is no one but a great philosopher, a German philosopher particularly, named Friedrich Wilhelm Nietzsche. He was a German philosopher, cultural critic, composer, poet, writer, and a very renowned philologist. If you go through his works, you will realize that his works have exerted a profound influence on modern intellectual history of the world. He began his career as a classical philologist before turning to philosophy. He became the youngest person ever to hold the chair of classical philology at the University of Basel in 1869, that too at the age of 24. So here, in this context of the lesson, author is giving an example of a great philosopher who is sometimes called a prophet Nietzsche in this regard. Gardiner says that, "I find myself wondering what sort of a person it is who can sit behind that hog-like outrage without realizing that he is the spirit of Prussia incarnate and a very ugly spectacle in a civilized world." Now you see the kind of examples which are quoted by the author over here. First of all, he talks about Nietzsche, who has always expected the educated, cultured human beings to be honest in life. That was his first principle of life, I would say. You can see it here also. He expected everybody to be honest. And honesty is the best policy, what I personally believe. So in this regard, when you come to know about the kind of examples given by A.G. Gardiner over here, on one side you have the gentle people living their life based on the moral conduct. On the other hand, you have the people like the motorists or the Germans, those who are invading the other, you know, territories and trying to show their upper hand. Then in the next expression, the author talks about Prussia. Prussia incarnate. Now I'm trying to show you the kind of background. Just behind me you can see presently, you will realize that this is the spirit of Prussia incarnate. But first of all, you need to understand, what do you mean by that Prussia incarnate? Actually, the unification of Germany into the German Empire, it was highly dominated by a Prussia dominated nation state with federal features, officially occurred on 18th of January 1871 at the Versailles Palace Hall of Mirrors in France. Princes of the German states gathered there to proclaim William of Prussia as the emperor of the German Empire after the French capitulation in the Franco-Prussian War. So this is the actual reference to this particular one. Probably The author is trying to present an idea that as long as you try to show your upper hand upon others, this behavior is actually not acceptable in the civilized world. Because whatever happened over there, probably that was the very ugly spectacle in a civilized world. And there is the more harmless person who has brought a very blatant gramophone and on Sunday afternoon sets the things going, open the windows and fills the street with keep the home fires burning or some similar banality. What are the rights? What are the right limits of social behavior in a matter of this sort? Let us take the trombone as an illustration again. Hazlitt said that a man who wanted to learn that fearsome instrument was entitled to learn it in his own house, even though he was a nuisance to his neighbors. But it was his business to make the nuisance as slight as possible. He must practice in the attic and shut the windows. He had no right to sit in his front room, open the windows, and blow his noise into his neighbor's ears with the maximum of violence. And so, with the gramophone, if you like the gramophone, you are entitled to have it, but you are interfering with the liberties of your neighbors. If you don't do what you can limit the noise to your own household, your neighbors may not like keep the home fires burning. They may prefer to have their Sunday afternoon undisturbed, and it is as great as impertinence for you to willfully trespass on their peace as it would be to go unasked into their gardens and trample on their flower beds. See the kind of idea which is processed by the author over here. Once again, he talks about the kind of disturbance which is created by the people. If you remember, yesterday I talked about this musical instrument called trombone. Now you can see this particular image just as the background of your screen. So here the author is giving another example that sometimes the people really disturb others, whereas we have no right to disturb them. Sometimes you get a fancy that you want to play some tunes on your gramophone. Nowadays we don't use gramophones. We have the highly sophisticated digital, you know, audio systems available. And if at all you get a fancy that you want to play some of the songs, your favorite songs on your audio system, and that too in the on the Sunday afternoon, probably if at all your voice frequency is limited to your own domain of house, fine. But if you are putting it the highest or the optimal possible, your neighbors will get disturbed. You may have the right to sing your song along with your karaoke sound system, but others also have the right to enjoy their Sunday in their own ways. But there are a few people, those who do like this. In this respect, your author again mentions that the case he talked about playing a trombone at home. Maybe you like to play with this musical instrument at your home, But at the same time, the inmates of your family or the other family members or the people living in your neighborhood, they too have their own right to live in cool and calm place. You are not supposed to create any sort of sound pollution over there by your fancy of playing some songs on the gramophone or some sort of, you know, music that you are creating out of your trombone. How far can you really do so? If at all you want to enjoy it, either you go to the isolated places where the people will never disturb you because nobody will be there around. But as long as you are there in the civilized society, you should always remember that the noise that you are creating, if it is limited to your own household, no issue. But if you are creating a kind of sound pollution to others, the others will definitely object it. And if at all something goes wrong with you, they will have the kind of attitude that let the house, you know, be set on fire or keep the home fires burning. Nobody will even intimate you because you have become a nuisance creator for them. When we live in a civilized society, first of all, we have to see that we, being an individual, should not be nuisance to others, and we can anticipate or expect the same from others as well. If you yourself is going to create nuisance to others, how can you expect that others will not create any sort of nuisance to you? In fact, you have no right to trespass on their peace, whatever kind of cool and calm life they are trying to live. Okay, unasked into their gardens and trample on their flower beds. You cannot do so. You have no right to trespass in their personal affairs. As far as your rights are concerned, you want to protect your rights, but at the same time, always remember that you should always be cautious enough to take care of the rights of the other people. There are cases, of course, where the clash of liberties seems to defy compromise. My dear old friend X, the author did not mention the name of the friend here. He wants to keep it, you know, a kind of secret from all, who lives in a West End square and who is an amazing mixture of good nature and irascibility, flies into a passion when he hears a street piano and rushes out to order it. But nearby lives a distinguished lady of romantic picaresques who dotes on street piano and attracts them as wasps are attracted to a jar of jam, whose liberty in this case should surrender to the author. For the life of me, I cannot say it is as reasonable to like street pianos as to dislike them, and vice versa. I would give much to hear Sancho Panza's solution of such a nice riddle. See now, in this respect, the author has given another example, and now he says that there are cases, of course, there are cases in our surrounding where the clash of liberties seems to defy compromise. But mind it well. In this respect, I would like to tell you one thing. If you really want to live a happy life, I think you should really learn to make compromises in your life. But if you really deny to do so, mind it well, the things will go wrong for you. And here, the author talks about the clash of liberties. What kind of clash of liberty is there? I will give first preference to my own liberty, but similarly, I am supposed to be very careful about others' liberty. But if at all there is a clash between my liberty and others' liberty, there will be definitely a kind of disturbance. So here, the author talks about to defy compromise. To defy means openly resist or refuse to obey. If you refuse to obey the compromise, mind it well, a clash will definitely take place, a confrontation will take place, it will lead to a conflict, and conflict may lead to a kind of, you know, quarrel between the two armies. So in this respect, he has given the example of his old friend X. X in the sense, the author did not mention the name of his friend who actually lives in a West End square and who is an amazing mixture of good nature and irascibility. Mind it well. In fact, you know, everybody else, including you and me as well, you know, we have a kind of temperament, we have a kind of behavior, which is the mixture of something good and something bad. You don't find a person who is perfectly good or perfectly bad, who is fully good or completely bad. We don't find such kind of people. Every individual has something good and maybe something bad as well. So here, the author talked about his friend, whose name is not mentioned over here. But as a matter of fact, when it comes to your likings and dislikings, you cannot simply live on your own preferences. You should really be ready in order to compromise few issues where you find a kind of confrontation with the people. Never create a situation that will lead to the conflict. So in this respect, the author has talked about this person who flies into a passion when he hears a street piano and he rushes out to order it away. Who has given you the right to do so? Your likings, your dislikings, why the people will really bother about you if you don't bother about them? Right. But nearby lives a distinguished lady of romantic picarestes who dotes on street pianos and attracts them as wasps are getting attracted towards a jar of jam. Right. Now here the question is, whose liberty is in this case should be surrendered to the other? See, you cannot have double standards in life. If you have one opinion, form the opinion and follow the opinion. In the respect of one person, you have one opinion. And in the same context, in the respect of another person, you have a different stand. This will not be tolerated by any. So it is as reasonable to like street pianos as to dislike them and vice versa. Depends on an individual. So the author says, I would give much to hear Sancho Panza's solution to such a riddle. So here you need to understand, what do you mean by the Sancho Panza's solution? Actually, Sancho Panza is a fictional character in the novel of Don Quixote, written by Spanish author Don Miguel de Cervantes Saavedra. So whatever solution is being offered by this fictional character in the novel is really acceptable to the author over here. And that's why he is saying that, I would give much to hear Sancho Panza's solution of such a nice riddle. Now you see here, In the subsequent paragraph, the author says, I suppose the fact is that we can be neither complete anarchist nor complete socialist in this complex world. Or rather, we must be a judicious mixture of both. We have both. Liberty is to preserve our individual liberty and our social liberty. We must watch the bureaucrat on the one side and wall of the anarchist on the other side. I am neither a Marxist nor a Tolstoyan, but a compromise. I shall not permit any authority to say that my child must go to this school or that, shall specialize in science or arts, shall play rugby or soccer. These things are personal. But if I proceed to say that my child shall have no education at all and that he shall be brought up as a primeval savage or at Mr. Fagin's academy for pickpockets, then society will politely but firmly tell me that it has no use for primeval savage and a very stern objection to pickpockets, and that my child must have a certain minimum of education, whether I like it or not. I cannot have the liberty to be a nuisance to my neighbors or make my child a burden and a danger to the commonwealth. See the kind of ideas which are expressed by the author over here towards the end of his essay. Here the author says, I suppose the fact that we can neither be complete anarchist nor complete socialist, but we are the mixture, a mixture of both. Because this world is a very complex one. You can neither be an anarchist nor a socialist. And author also proclaims that he himself is neither a Marxist nor a Tolstoyan. Because Marxist ideas and Tolstoy's ideas are sometimes they are not, you know, matching together. They have different polar extents. And here you need to accept one thing, that when we live our life in a society, it is the judicious mixture of anarchist ideas and socialist ideas. We have both liberties to preserve. We have individual liberty and social liberty. Of course, I want to protect my individual liberty as well as the social liberty. But when I am very particular about my own individual liberty, I should also be considerate about the social liberty of others. And when I am into my social liberty, automatically I expect that the other members of the society should be, you know, considering my social liberty as well. So when you keep an eye upon a bureaucrat, you should also keep an eye upon an anarchist. And that's why the author says, I am neither a Marxist nor a Tolstoyan, but a compromise of both. So I do follow some of the ideas of Marx, Karl Marx, and I do follow some of the ideas of Leo Tolstoy, and I am living my life with a compromise with both the ideas. See, I shall not permit any authority to say anything about my child. Which school my child should go, what kind of subject my child should really learn. He should really play rugby or soccer or any other game, or he should get involved in any other activity. These are all personal issues. No one can really object me for all that. But if at all I decide that my child is not going to get any sort of education, and I want to, you know, brought up my child as a primeval savage, and I want to send my child to Mr. Fagin's Academy for pickpockets, I think if at all I take this kind of stand, the society will politely but firmly tell me that a primeval savage has no place in the society at all. You cannot send your child to a kind of academy where pickpocketing is taught or the pickpocketers are trained. So you have to provide minimum education to your child in order to let him live a good life in the society by considering the liberties of all. I cannot simply brought up my child as a nuisance to the neighbors and the society. So here, if at all I do so, my child will be a burden and a danger to the commonwealth.